best way is to just jump into it, right? That's what I always do. Disk-free space, we have enough. Okay, so we're okay there. Who knows if the program will work or not? Never know, right? Never know. Very beautiful evening here in California. Crickets are humming away. And I'm under a great urgency to bring in the right focus here. Did a great petitioning of Longchenpa last night. Greatest petitioning contemplation I've ever done in my life. And so the result of that is that I'm able to focus in on track on what I need to say. What I need to say is very simple. And we need to practice just simply this. I'm already enlightened. It's already happened. I don't have any idea how it happened, really. It's as if an enlightenment never happened, actually. It's gone. No way to trace it. And just sit in the wow of that. This is the real practice, actually. This is the only practice we really needed at all. That whatever it is that I'm enlightened from has vanished without a trace, as if it never was, and there's no way to trace it. So I don't even, I don't know how it happened, but it's happened. I'm already enlightened. It's finished. Nothing for me to do in terms of that enlightenment anymore. I'm done. And I didn't even have an enlightenment experience at all. No enlightenment experience. It already happened. I don't know what happened, how it happened, what happened to what was acted upon, if anything. It's all vanished without a trace. So just do this practice. And then just wow it. Wow. I'm already here. And I don't know how I got here. That's okay. Practice this. Just practice this and nothing else. Now, you're going to say, well, what comes after? Well, what comes after is at some point you will very clearly see what it is that you did. You will see clearly that all of this, what we call existence, bodies, worlds, was just complete make-believe. Utter and complete make-believe. There was nothing that had to be attained. Nothing attainable. It's really much ado about absolutely nothing. It's channeling nothing. We're imagining that out of nothing came this other God and an other self, and that this other God produces these dynamics that this other self is then experiencing within. That we call, the body. This other dynamics we call the world. And we think this other God created this world. And we think that this other self is going through all these experiencings, life and death and rebirth and all of this stuff, all as part of the dynamics of this other God, that this other God created all these dynamics, created the soul of this other soul. And all of this is total make-believe on our part. Believing that this is coming from nothing, but we're channeling nothing. This is what nothing has produced. We're producing all of it in our creativity. We wanted to use creativity in a really weird way, so this is what we have done. But nothing at all has taken place. There's no practice needed. There's nothing to escape. It's all make-believe. This other self is a make-believe self. This other God is a make-believe God. This other realm, these dynamics, all make-believe. Time, space, process, form, totally make-believe. At some point, we will see that very clearly. And then we'll just have a little laugh, and then that's it. Okay. That's it. Now, this is what Jesus tells us. We'll just have a little laugh, a little chuckle, and and then he said, then you'll be done with it all. There's no interest anymore, okay? This is all we have to practice, actually, is that we're already there. That we're already completely free of any need for any practice. But this is the final practice. You might say the one and only practice is to practice realizing we're already enlightened. So how could we need any practice to get enlightened? It's ridiculous. We don't need any. It's already done. And I don't know how it was done, but it's inescapably done. There's no trace. It's vanished. Whatever it is that I thought I needed to work on to be enlightened is completely gone. All the sadness gone. So I can't transform sadness into happiness. The sadness, everything I thought I needed to transform, it's all vanished without a trace. And we only need to practice accepting this. Like, that's okay. That doesn't bother me. Or practice getting over the upset of it. Or maybe it bothers us a little bit. Sure. So we just sit in the wow of this. Like, wow. How amazing is this? Now, is this backed up by teachers? Yes, it is. Longchenpa backs it up. Jesus Christ backs it up. Ramaharshi backs it up. The Dharma kings back it up. Jamyang Genzi Choki Lodro backs it up. Chandra Sering Chodron backs it up. In fact, she's the one that really gave me a boost in this, as I was at a golf course taking practice swings, and this eccentric, odd-looking lady walked past on the sidewalk. And I felt something very odd was going on. Intuitively, I said, something here is not right, or at least this is something way out of the ordinary is going on. Spiritually, I was aware of it at some level. But I said, well, she doesn't really want me to look at her, so I'll just continue doing what I'm doing and see what happens. So I teed the ball up, par 3 hole, and I stepped back from it, and I took a couple of practice swings, the first practice swing, and then this lady burst out into laughter, giggling and laughter. I was like, what? I wonder what she's laughing about. Then I took a second practice swing, and this time she just erupted in laughter. Like, this was the stupidest thing I've ever seen. Like, it was hilarious. Like, I missed the ball. I thought, what, doesn't she understand I'm taking practice? I'm not trying to hit the ball. And then I finally hit the ball, and I looked, and she was gone. And so this shook me up to the core. And as I went on, I didn't get angry. It began to emerge in me, like, what's going on here? Is that somehow I realized I don't need to practice. Practice is totally stupid. Practice is totally stupid. Just get up and hit the ball. In other words, you're already there. Direct approach. Just a completely direct approach. I'm already enlightened. There's nothing I can do about it. It's already been done. It's inescapable. I'm already the enlightened guru. I'm an enlightened guru right this instant. There's nothing I can do about it. There's no way I can undo it. There's no evidence at all present of how I did it. And of course, trying to have evidence of how I did it gives me an opportunity to undo it. There's no opportunity to undo it at all. Inescapable. Nothing I can do about it. This is called the direct approach. So what she was doing by ridiculing my practicing was help me realize there's nothing you need to practice. Now, when we hit the ball, we might say the final practice is, again, there's nothing we need to practice. That would be obviously inferred. There's nothing we need to practice, except we need to practice that there's nothing to practice. So, this is where we're at. This is what is so difficult to bring into focus in this world. This is what may be causing depression in many people, is the keep thinking, well, I've got to do something to be enlightened. I don't know what to do. What do I need to, I need to attain something. I don't know what to attain. And you go into depression from this. Just realize there's nothing you need to do. You're already enlightened. It's already happened. Done. It's already done. It's in the past tense, so to speak. It didn't just happen. I don't know when it happened. See, I don't know when it happened. I have no idea when it happened, but I realize I'm enlightened. I don't know how it happened. I don't know when it happened, but I find myself enlightened now. I love this video by Brett Novak called Searching Sirocco. Searching Sirocco. S-I-R-O-C-C-O, maybe. Or just S-I-R-O-C-C-O. Searching Sirocco. It's wonderful. It's wonderful. I recommend it. Searching Sirocco. Brett Novak. It's on YouTube. It's on YouTube. It starts out with somebody stuck in the snow up to their hips, and they're trying to get free. And they say, oh, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? And somehow we suddenly shift from below, and we're seeing the leg wiggling in space, and suddenly the body drops through, and he's in this desert. And it's just like, it's a mind blower. It's one of the greatest opening scenes of any I've ever seen in a film or video or anything. It's so unexpected. I don't want to ruin it for you. But this throughout the skateboarder, Killian Martin, he keeps going from one realm, dropping into the other. And he's like looking around. And it's like, he gives this impression of like, I have no idea how I got here. I don't know where I am, or how I got here, or when I got here. And he's just looking around to say, whoa. And then he says, but I see something to skate on. I'm okay. It's brilliant. It's brilliant. It's a very deep spiritual Zogchenist, non-dualist Zogchenist video. So it's like suddenly I'm free of all troubles. I was stuck in the snow. I think I might die. It's terrible. And suddenly I'm in this wide open spaciousness of this beautiful desert. And is this a problem? He says, no. I see somewhere to skate. So in other words, I'm going to do my thing. I see somewhere where I can have fun and do my thing. I'm okay. And he keeps doing this throughout the video. It's And someone made a big point of pointing out this skater and this cinematographer, Brett Novak. Someone who's very deep, he said, you got to see this. You got to watch this. And then I found this movie, Searching Sirocco. And then I told him, watch this, man. And he watched it. And he got back to me a couple days ago. And he said, I watched that video, man. And it just blew my mind. He said, I get goosebumps just thinking about it. And when he was telling me, I was getting goosebumps too. He said, that was just completely surreal. Just, I can't even explain it. It was just, this is the experience that people are having with this video. It is very, very evocative of sudden enlightenment. And it's okay to be suddenly enlightened. But not even sudden, already enlightened. So, you know, the Chan school and the Indian school, sudden enlightenment school, and the Madhyamika, whatever it was, a gradualist. I don't know if Madhyamika was around at that time. Maybe no, it was. King Trisong Detson. Yeah, it was. Is it sudden or is it gradual? The answer is neither. The answer is neither. It's already done. And I don't know when it happened. I don't know when it happened. I have no idea when it happened. I don't have any idea how it happened. So how can I say it's sudden or gradual? I have no idea how it happened or when it happened. So it's neither sudden nor gradual, nor a combination thereof. And this is what we've been missing throughout the millennia. Longchenpa knows this, and this, and the Dzogchenists knows this, which is why they were persecuted. They weren't really teaching sudden enlightenment. They were teaching something else. And they were driven underground in Tibet, and ultimately when the Gelugpas gained the height of their powers, so it was the 18th century or something, that they were really severely persecuted, driven into calm eastern Tibet, underground. Their texts became banned, you know, only secret, only the highest lamas could have access to them, and it was all secret and stuff. And what is it they were so worried about persecuting, you know? Interesting, isn't it? People say Longchenpa's a Vajrayana Buddhist. I don't know about that, actually. He may have written a lot of pith instructions and this and that, but what I get from him is he's beyond that. He actually sort of left it, turned his back on it all. So no, this isn't really it. So it's neither, enlightenment is neither sudden nor gradual. We don't know how it happens or when it happens. But we know it's already happened. And there's no trace at all left of what happened, or no way to determine when it happened or what happened, really. We just realize that I'm already enlightened. And then okay, here's somewhere to skate. So, movie of the century, you know. I think it's like about a 6-minute movie. And my friend told me, I felt like I was watching this short film, a short film. And people say, it seems like it's timeless. It goes on for so, it just stretches our mind out some way. Searching Sirocco. Sirocco, I believe it's that. Brett Novak, Searching Sirocco, Killian Martin. You can find it on YouTube. Killian Martin. Martin, I think. Martin. It's really worth watching. It's beyond a skate film. It is way beyond that. It's a spiritual film. It's a spiritual video. A great spiritual video. I don't know what else I would say to watch this better than that. I mean, it's a great spiritual video. And it's funny because there's nothing externally spiritual about it as far as bells and whistles and anything, not at all. He's just making a movie for skateboarders, supposedly. And everybody has the same similar comments, like, wow, that was amazing. Amazing. It brings up something within us that, oh my gosh, already enlightened. I don't know how I got here in the realm of enlightenment, but it's okay. And then later on, it dawns upon us very clearly. I was just all make-believe, and it doesn't matter. What happens to make-believe doesn't matter in the slightest bit. Nothing needs to happen to it. I just stopped make-believing. That's all. And when doesn't matter. There's no when to eternity. There's no reason to attach a when to it or a how to it. So the epic confrontation between the gradualness and the suddenness, it's been resolved. Longchenpa resolved it for me. Over the last, couple weeks. And that it's neither. We don't know when it happened or how it happened. But I see a nice place to skate. I wish I could skate really well. I really could. Once when I saw Rodney Mullen in videos, I went to sleep and I began daydreaming, kind of daydreaming, like in my mind, and I was actually skating better in my mind. I was just doing unbelievably great stuff skating. Just awesomely fun stuff. Wow. Never falling. Just all these beautiful moves and going and just skating up everything and flying and flipping and spinning and carving and just, it was just a blast. I can't remember when I've had so much fun in my mind. What a blast that was. I wish we could do that. But no harm can come in the dreaming. No harm could come to me at all. Can't break any bones. And then Killian Martin too, I was imagining skating all this stuff like in India, skating in India, inside India or something. There's an Indian film. You look, watch the films of Brett Novak. My friend said I watched that, and I was watching all these videos, all these videos. And he said it was just blew my mind. It just blew my mind. And in some way, it does. What's the guy's name? They're doing Jason Park or something like that in Hawaii, Forever My Home or something like that. That's a really cool one too, but it's the different style. I think Jason Park has a different style. The skateboards have different styles, which is nice, and it's kind of like. It's almost like a dreamlike thing, actually, because when you try to do that on a skateboard, you have no clue, and so it seems like you're having a dream as you're watching them. Actually, it doesn't seem real at all what you're watching. It's like you're somehow awake, but you're watching a dream while you're awake. This is so amazing. It just blew my mind. When we go to sleep and we're dreaming, our dreams are really weird, right? All this stuff's happening. We're daydreaming, but. We're asleep when we're doing this. But what if we were like awake and we're watching these dreams? Now, movies kind of give us that impression, don't they? They try to give the impression of dreams and that we're awake watching them. But these skateboard videos, they really bring it home in a stronger way. It's quite extraordinary. I mean, I saw that this video by Rodney Mullen. And I just had, I had to pinch myself. I said, am I dreaming? Am I awake? Am I dreaming? Am I really watching this? Is this really happening? And maybe it's on the vert ramp, some get like Tony Hawk doing his stuff. They may get that same feeling, like this must be a dream. I'm awake, but I'm experiencing a dream. How cool is that? Wow. It does something spiritually to us. It helps us in some way to recognize already enlightened. It's very helpful. It's funny, like. Keep in mind that Dzogchen was not a monastic tradition. It was a lay tradition, mostly, of just lay people like myself, some lower class person, some middle class person, some upper class person, just going about their lives, and nobody even knew they were practicing or anything. It was just, there was no formal head of it or anything like that, and no organization, Dzogchen organization or anything. But there were these masters that went around and helped empower, sort of, somehow. And so, you might just be a skateboarder, you might be a Dzogchenist, right? Or a skateboard filmmaker, and you're actually a secret Dzogchenist or something. Nobody even knows. So these videos just hammered me strongly. And they hammered my friend, too. He's very deep, old soul. You wouldn't know it. You wouldn't know it at all. You wouldn't know, but every time he talks with me, he reveals more and more. Like he doesn't make any excuses for anything. He says we control our own destiny. Everything that's happening, it's our own It's our own dream. It's our own thing, right? And no excuses. No accidents, no excuse, all this stuff. That's very Dzogchen, it's very non-dual, very advanced. And so these videos just blew his mind, as they blew my mind as well. And that's why I posted them on the Facebook page, but people didn't watch them. I removed one, the Holy Spirit wanted me to remove one. For some reason, they said no, don't put that one there. So I finally removed it. The Holy Spirit has its reasons. It kept bugging me about it. I didn't quite have the right feel or something. It was somehow, and actually the skateboarders didn't like that video. It was very interesting. They all kind of dissed it. I thought it was great, but they didn't like it. So there's something, it was done by Vogue 360, Rodney Mullen. And it was all kind of artsy, the way it was done, dark and artsy and slow-mo and everything. I thought it was very, very creative. But the skaters, most of them were really upset, didn't like it. So there's some reason for that. And I was told to take it down. So I did. So the tricks that these top skaters do are so freaking amazing. If you're a skateboarder, the people who watch these videos are skateboarders. Why? Because it blows their minds. They say, what? Now, these are hardcore skateboarders, and they're watching Rodney Mullen, and they just say, "What did he do? Did I just see what I saw? I don't have any idea what he just did. I just don't have any idea." What? Like magicians or something out of skateboards. And it, once you see it a number of times, then you start gradually seeing somewhat what they did. But how they did it is a whole nother story. And nailing it and landing it, it seems like magic. It just seems impossible. It seems like a dream. I mean, if you want to see someone watch across Niagara Falls, it's like, okay, it's dangerous. Oh, it might fall. But you see what they're doing. They're walking across a tightrope. But all this skateboard stuff is like, what? It seems like they're defying the laws of gravity and nature, really. And that is very cool. It seems like a dream, where they're just doing whatever they want to do, and gravity and balance and nature doesn't have anything to do with it. Nothing to do with it. This is so amazing. And I thought maybe I could try to do that. That's why I crashed. I gotta get on this. I gotta get, start. Maybe I could do that. I was thinking, maybe I could do that. I still think maybe I could should be able to do it. But I saw these guys trying to do these tricks, and they kept missing, falling. So these guys would practice this just like, Rodney Mullen was like 5-8 hours a day, every single day, just practice and practice and practice and practice and practice and iron it and iron it out, iron it out. So it's just like the timing is just all perfect. Everything, the touches they do with their foot as they're spinning it, and then they touch it and kick it with their foot perfectly as they're flying through the air over stairs, and then landing it perfect at the bottom of the stairs after these flipping and kicking the board through the air. Man, I just don't understand how they can do that. And how do they learn that? Bit by bit, right? Little steps, doing it just a little thing, and then somehow they know how to flip the board and kick the board with a foot, and so it lands perfectly on the four wheels on the ground, the bottom of the staircase, and they land almost at the same time directly on the board. Good Lord, it seems to defy possibility, So, but we can use this to wake us up somehow. It's like, how did they land it? I don't know, but they landed it, It's like that. I don't know how it happened. I don't know what happened and how it happened, but they landed it and they're skating on. You know, it's like enlightenment, what we're talking about, already enlightened. I don't know how I did it. Okay. I don't know what happened or how I did it or when I did it, but somehow I landed on this. I'm on the skateboard and I'm skating on. Everything's fine. So it's a beautiful metaphor for I'm already enlightened, which is why I was guided to skateboarding and guided to these videos. It's a powerful metaphor if you're awake to it. I don't know how I did it. I don't know how it happened, but all's good. I thought I was like backflipping down some stairs and kicking and flipping a board, but I don't know. I don't know how I did it. I don't know really what happened, but I'm on the skateboard cruising down the sidewalk. You know, all's fine. Yeah. So there's a way to use this stuff in a very positive way. Already enlightened. Don't know how, I don't know when, I don't know what happened. I don't know what happened, when it happened. But everything's fine. Skate on down the sidewalk. I haven't skated on a sidewalk yet because I haven't figured out how to stop. And I got to get back on the board and figure out a few things. Or not. I don't know. We'll see what the Holy Spirit has to say, the guidance. But what's important here is this practice and how we're being supported in this practice by the great Dzogchenist himself, Longchenpa. This is deep. It's amazing, isn't it? It's amazing. And yet it's here. It wasn't easy to get it here. A lifetime of effort to get it here. Trying to speak up in the face of everything else other than this. Trying to find some space for this. Trying to give it some air. And this is just knocking me out, which is great. I hope it's knocking you out as much as it's knocking me out. I'm just imagining, you know, skateboard film I could make, something, you know, it's just to illustrate that. This is what needs to be illustrated. We need to start a culture of this. A Longchenpa culture. It's very different than the interpretations of Dzogchen. It's very different. This is a beyond that. I find interpretations of Dzogchen from many different respects, I always felt like that's not quite it. They're missing it still. But this is not missing it. This is it. Again, no enlightenment experience, no idea what happened, no idea when it happened, or if anything happened, actually. I simply don't know, but I'm skating on down the sidewalk, and everything's fine. I see all sorts of enjoyable, wow, I could skate there, I could skate there, I could skate there. I wish I was a great skateboarder. I'll tell you that, I really do wish that. That would be fun. I would really enjoy it. But I'm an idiot. These guys are just daredevils, acrobat daredevils, you know. And when they wipe out, they land on their feet somehow most of the time. I mean, they're just, a lot of them are, I mean, they're just extraordinary. I just wish I could just roll, let's go. You know, let's go down those stairs. Let's just do it. Just hopping, jumping, and never wiping out. But darn. First time I tried to do the slightest little thing, I wipe out and just about kill myself. You know, it's like, oh my God. It was on plywood. It was so gave. I mean, just the concrete is just like, oh my gosh. So, but I wish I was just like a kid just jumping curves and jumping this and flying all over the place and just tearing it up in my mind. I can just tear it up better than any of those kids are tearing. I mean, I'm telling you, I'm just jumping everything and just doing these acrobatic tricks that you can't believe. Oh, it's just a blast. And I'm jumping off something and I'm spinning and I end up in another world. You know, another realm. I take off over, you know, sliding down this handrail, this massive stairway, and it goes down more and more and more and more. I'm going faster, faster, faster down the rail. Faster, faster, faster down the rail. And it's hundreds of stairs, going, and then I fly off at the bottom, you know, and land. And I'm skating, I'm in a different realm, I'm in a different world. I'm in a different world. Wow, I'm just thinking of videos I could make. Wow. So amazing to practice, viewing and practice, that you do this amazing acrobatic thing, and then just you land, and you're in a completely different realm. It's just, and then you say, "Oh, but, oh, cool! This is even better. I see something really great to skate in here," and you just flow right into that. This is just really expanding my mind. Don't even know how I got here. Did I even get here? I don't know. Have I always been here? I don't know. Doesn't really matter, does it? I'm here. And there's something fun to do. Wow. In fact, I just had a great idea. I think I can do something. I'm having really great ideas now of, wow. More and more of these skate videos, ideas are coming to me. Where it's more like filming it. I don't have to... skate much myself, maybe a little bit. But it's just the special effects and cutting and editing. The point is not the skating. It's like, what happens? What can happen? Wow. Okay, so this is amazing. This is amazing what's going on here. Maybe I should have kept Skate Satsang. The name Skate Satsang. Maybe that was the right name. I had to put spiritual cross-training. Well, we can use that in a skate satsang as a particular genre in that of spiritual cross-training. So don't go out and like start trying to do a bunch of tricks on your skateboard. That's not what it's about. Watch the videos, actually. That's more what it's about. And let it be a metaphor for already awakened, already enlightened. I don't even know if I had an enlightenment experience or not, or when it happened, where it happened, how it happened. I don't know. When, where, how, I have no idea. This is the real practice. This is what the world will never tell you. But this is the real practice. All thanks to Longchenpa. I put forth the most extraordinary petitions I've ever done in my life, 1,000 times better than anything I've ever done. I was all in. And I very directly presented my case to Longchenpa for help. I said, keep this in mind. Keep this in mind. Let this weigh heavily in your decision to help. I present this with confidence to you. I present this with confidence in your decision. This is why I'm confident in petitioning you. And so I did all these reasons that I felt, because of this, I feel very confident in petitioning you. Let this weigh very heavily in your judgment. And I want you and keep this in mind. Keep this fact in mind. And I presented the case of my life, everything I've done, our situation, how important it is that he give his assent to help us, his consent to help us. It was I didn't time it. It was long. It was impassioned. It was silent. I did it in my mind. I didn't want to tape it because this was very important, intense. I wanted to just get into it without any thought of taping or anything, and I just presented this case to him as best I could possibly present it, of, this is why I petition you with confidence. I want this to weigh heavily in your mind, and I want you to keep this in mind. What I tell you, I want you to keep this in mind. You know, and so I just made the best petition of my life of why he should help us. So on the behalf of all of you, I petitioned the Dharma King Longchenpa in my very best way. And I said, I will continue to keep petitioning you until you give your assent. I will not stop. Well, I had to go to bed, and the next day all this drama happened and stuff. But I believe that the petition was, you know, I gave my very best. And it's not a matter of just repeating over and over. I mean, I gave so many reasons, hundreds of reasons, in defense of us here right now in the West, where what myself, you know, yeah, I don't know this, but this is what I've done. You know, this is the discipline. This is what the effort I put in. This is where I'm at. This is this. I just remind them. Let me remind you of all of this. I want to tell you of this and keep this in your mind, and let this weigh heavily in your decision making process. And I petition you with confidence, because this is where I'm at. This is what I believe in. This is how much I believe in you. And I said, even if I'm an idiot, I still have enough wisdom to petition you. And I said, let this weigh very heavily in your mind. Let this in your decision. Let this weigh very heavily. I may be incompetent and stupid and terrible and an idiot, but I still have the wisdom, Longchenpa, to be petitioning you directly and adamantly. Keep this in your mind, I said. Keep this in your mind. We may be sewer rats here, but we are petitioning you for your direct assistance. So let this weigh heavily in your Dharma mind. So I trust you to have this Dharma mind and Dharma decision, this your Dharma King decision, where you view it in a truly inspired way. Yeah, we may be rats here. I told him, maybe we're all sewer rats, okay? We're idiots here, sewer rats. We're despicable. And yet here we are with all the distractions in the world going on. I said, Longchenpa, I'm not watching baseball. I'm not doing anything, except right now I am petitioning you to the utmost. That's what I'm doing. So let that rest heavily in my favor. Let this weigh heavily in my favor. Let this weigh heavily in a favorable way towards me. Because I could be doing anything else, infinite other things, and yet I'm not. I am completely laser focused in on petitioning you for help. That's what I'm doing. So let this weigh very heavily towards, you know, a favorable decision to help us. Let this weigh very heavily. I want it to weigh very heavily. I don't want this to be overlooked. So I brought up all sorts of things that an ordinary mind would overlook. So I want him to know that I don't expect him to overlook these things, because I am bringing these to his attention, and I trust that he is not going to overlook these things. These are very buried things that nobody would think of, but I thought of them. It's kind of like, you know, I may be an idiot, but I'm not such an idiot that I have forgotten to petition you and to trust in you, that you are hearing this petition and giving it utmost attention. I have enough wisdom to do that, you see, so doesn't that make me worthy in your eyes to help me out and help us out? I believe it does, you see. I believe it does. Otherwise, I would not be raising this petition. We're not doing anything else. I said, I may be distracted, I may be crazy, stupid, but I'm not doing anything else except petitioning you. That's all my mind is doing right now. There's nothing else on my mind whatsoever. So, can I really be that incompetent? Let this weigh in your mind heavily, Longchenpa. Yes, I may be incompetent, but also there's this other factor that I want to trump the other ones. I want it to trump it. You see, I'm saying this should trump the other stuff. This is how I see it. So I presented how I see it, how I feel I'm justified in petitioning for help and receiving it. I've never done anything like this in my life, but I'm desperate. And I said, it's time to take the opportunity. They took the chance. I said, I'm going to lay it on the line here, Longchenpa, and just go into you. Actually, a friend of mine is very interesting. He helped me. He doesn't even know how he helps me, but he does. It's really astonishing. Everybody helps me in an astonishing way, actually. He said that he told me Friday, this last Friday, he said, I finally went in and had it out with the boss because it's been boiling up inside of him. He's so upset about the job and how he's being treated and unappreciated and all this. And his boss finally went to him and went by him and he said, hey, what's bugging you? I want to know what's bugging you. And so he said, okay, I'll tell you. And so they went in behind closed doors and he told them what's bugging him. He said, what's wrong? He says, the boss asked him, what's wrong? He says, you're what's wrong. And then he said, what do you mean? I mean, explain it to me. And then he said, well, this, and he gave him a piece of his mind. And he said, this is, what's upset. And he was sure he was going to get fired. He was sure he was going to get fired. And he didn't get fired. And the boss listened to him and said, huh, well, now he said, well, anything's going to change it. I doubt it. But who's to say? How do we know? Maybe this got through to him. The boss asked him, says, okay, what's bugging you? What's on your mind? And he just let it all out. What guts did that take? I'm telling you. I told him, wow, this is very inspiring. What guts? Because you thought that's it, you're going to lose your job. But you were honest enough to tell the boss what's really on your mind. So somehow I was inspired by that. I said, Longchamp, I'm going to tell you what's on my mind. I'm going to tell you, I believe you should be helping me and helping us here. This, and maybe nobody else believes this. I don't know if you believe it, but I'm going to tell you how I feel and why I believe you should help us and why I feel that we're deserving of this help. And so I just absolutely laid it on the line of how I really felt. Well, but I never doubted him for a second that he was going to fire me or laugh at me or anything. Never, never, no. If I would have felt that, I wouldn't have said anything. Wouldn't have been worthy to even make the petition. I felt that he would honestly listen to the petition and take it to heart. Because it was from the heart. It was from the heart. And so, I told him exactly everything that was on my mind and where, how I see myself, how I see us, what I feel that we should deserve and expect, and how we can move forward, everything. And I said, what, and how I've prepared my whole life, and why, I should not be overlooked. So I'm sure he heard it and took it to heart. It was heart-to-heart talk. Heart-to-heart talk, as Ramana says, heart-to-heart talk is the best talk. That's the talk you should do. Heart-to-heart talk. And heart-to-heart hearing. So it was heart-to-heart talk, heart-to-heart hearing. And I went on and on and on and on and on and on. And I wouldn't quit. I said, I'm going to keep petitioning you until I get a favorable answer. I am not going to stop. And I said, that very fact itself should weigh heavily on your mind, that I am not going to stop petitioning you until I get a favorable response. That should weigh heav let that weigh heavily in your favor, and keep that in mind. I may be an idiot, but what kind of idiot petitions you ceaselessly without stopping, with total faith in your ability to help them? What kind of idiot is that? That might be an idiot that you must keep in mind. And not easily dismiss. So we may be idiots, but we want Longchenpa to help us out. I'm convinced that he knows the right practice for us. I'm convinced of that. That he knows what it's really about. We might be lousy, but we're willing, you see? We might be lousy, but we're willing. We're willing. We're willing to be helped. Let this weigh heavily in our favor, Longchenpa. We're willing to be helped. We're willing to listen. And I believe I have listened, and as this practice, I'm already enlightened. I don't know how, where, when, how, what happened, where it happened, when it happened, but everything is smooth, everything is peaceful. I feel fine. There's nothing wrong with me at all. And I see adventures, many adventures in front of me. Ah, how wonderful. Tell you something. I had an amazing miracle from Longchenpa several days ago, and he conveyed to me in no uncertain terms. It was brilliantly done. I can't even tell you how brilliantly he did it. It just floored me. He said, call on me, page me, page me. I want you to call on me. So he let me know he wanted me to call him. I said, okay, you asked for it. You're gonna, you know, here it comes. I don't know if he's ever been petitioned like that before. I don't know if anyone has. It was like do or die. You know, skate or die, Will. Petition or die. Petition Longchenpa or die. You know, so I said, let me not die. Let me petition him. Let me petition him. I'll do my best. It's either that or die. For me, it was petition or die. And I decided to petition him. What's the worst thing he can do? Turn me down. Okay? Then we die. Okay? Like everyone else seems to be dying. But at least we're going to give ourselves a chance. So this is super intense, you see. But why not? It's do or die. It's petition or die. So it better be intense. Nobody said that getting help wouldn't be intense, that this would not be intense. Yeah, it is. But it's worth it. I mean, why not suffer the intensity of it? Why not? Why not suffer the intensity of it? Amazing thing happened. One of our cars is lacking a battery, dead battery. It's been sitting for a long time. It's just so dirty and cobwebs and dusty, and it looks like the tires are flat, and we just abandon it. And then our go-to car wouldn't start this morning. I said, what? Uh-oh. call out the guy, test the battery. He said the battery's, oh, the battery's okay. Was it? It's the starter. Bad starter. Oh, shoot. Wow. But then we got, since he was out there, I said, well, can we get a new battery for this other one? Dead battery? He said, sure. So we got a new battery. And then I was able to drive it down and take it through the car wash and put air in the tires. And the car looks like brand new. It looks great. I mean, it's like, wow, it's suddenly resurrected from the dead. I mean, this car was left for dead. It really was. And I just couldn't do anything about it. I don't know what it was. But this suddenly just happened because the other car, we had to have this repair guy come out. And he was then able to put a battery in the other car, start it up. He said, it's good to go. Everything's fine. And we had to shuttle down to get the car down to the repair shop, shuttle. And so I was able to give it a car wash and put air in the tires. And darned if this car doesn't look beautiful again. And it's running like a champ. It's like, wow. It was so amazing. Everybody sees it. It's like, oh, it's back. Like it's back from the dead. Car is back from the dead. And everybody's so happy because we love that car. We love that car. It's been with us a long time. A long, long time. I can hardly tell you how long. It's been a long time. And it still runs great. Super visibility, great visibility. This is before all the junk, I mean, the way they changed cars. You know, now you can't see out the back, you can't see out the sides, you can't see anything. Gotta look at cameras to where you, I hate that. Computers, this is before computers. There's no computers on board whatsoever. It's before all this, you know, the way cars are. The guy was telling me all about the cars and how they are now. Now it's all about computers, totally. It's amazing what computers will do. I was just told, someone told me the new Dodges, they use so much oil, they burn so much oil. If you're low in gasoline, you can't even get the car in gear. I mean, you can't move the car. Well, what it is, something like, you have trouble backing up or doing anything, it gets your attention. The computers automatically modify the performance of the car. And if you have low oil, it will prevent you from revving the engine high power. It shuts it down. There's all sorts of things that it shuts the engine off, various areas. It goes from, you know, 8 cylinders to 4 or something. So already computers are controlling our cars more and more and more. It was amazing what he told me. All the technology that these new cars have, certainly they have governors on how fast you can go. They may likely soon have zones that prevent cars from going fast. That somehow they'll have like cameras on the car that will, and then some sort of maybe wireless information available or some sort of port there as you go on the freeway that tells the car how fast you're supposed to be going, and you can't go faster than that. You know what I mean? If we're getting very close to, this is why all the guys are taking their cars out all over the place in country roads and just driving so fast. I mean, he was telling me that he was talking about the younger generation. He's 23. And he said, yeah, I know all about it. Yeah. I said, really? He said, yeah. 160? Oh yeah. We're doing that. All the younger generation, we're all doing that. We're going out and driving 160 miles an hour. He says, no, it's not that dangerous. I said, really? He says, no. He said, well, I said, I wouldn't do it. He says, well, I said, what, you know, he says, the cars are so stable at that speed, you know, it's not a problem. I said, yeah, but the slowdown time, reaction time, everything. What if a jackrabbit jumps in, out in the road, or you know, something can happen? He said, yeah, you're right. You know, so he understood what I was saying. But they don't have any fear of going 160 miles an hour. And they're, you know, they're tweaking the computers. They're doing all sorts of stuff to the engines, modifying them, getting around the computers. So this is all very well known. It's just it's bizarre what's going on, the younger generation. And he told me a lot of stuff. He says that my generation, if you don't have a degree, and a high degree, like a master's degree, you don't have a chance. He said it's all about degrees now, and the work, the various kinds of experiences, your resume. You cannot just walk in a door. He said he knew someone, older person. That he said, like, I don't know if it was his dad or relative, that just he had a friend. He walked into the guy's friend. He said, "Hey, I'd like to work for you." His friend hired him on the spot. That's how we used to do it. That, for me, a job is you just know somebody and say, "Hey, I'd like to come work for you. I'd like to help your company out, and I think I'd do a good job for you." The guy said, "Oh," I said, "great. Yeah, I'd like to have you work for me." That, and done deal. Signed up. Start the next day. He said, "That's gone. It's gone, gone, gone. They won't even look at you." Is the jobs that I need to get just to have a life, I need a master's degree. He says, just to have a life, I have to have a master's degree. How long is it going to take? He says, from where I am now, 7 years of intense effort. I said, but that's what I have to do. That's what I'm going to do. He said, by the time I'm 30, hopefully I can land a job. And have enough money to survive. It's like, wow. I was like, blew my mind. And what? But I told him, you know, I said, I really feel sorry for you, but your generation is wired differently than ours. I said, I could never handle what your generation is facing. No way. No way. But you're wired differently. You know, you're set up to handle it. So I believe you can handle it. And he said, yeah, I hear what you're saying. That we are, you know, we're probably, you know, we probably can make it somehow. So we're wondering about what's going to happen to the younger generation. Oh, it's so terrible. No, they're different. They're different. He said, okay, yeah, I can make this. I can do this. I'll get my master's degree. I'll get a job in a high tech industry, and you know, with a modern technology of degree, and I'll be able to, you know, pull in enough money maybe to survive. And so they just, you know, they don't give up. They're not hanging their heads. You know, they're just saying, okay. But I talk to the young people, and you know, they're drinking energy drinks just to try and power through what they have to do. And this is why doctors are saying, I'm seeing all these young people come in with illnesses that only old people have. Because they're just burning themselves out so severely. And this is what they have to do. They just do what they have to do. Youth just does what it has to do to survive. It's just amazing, their attitude. You know, I'm just blown away by it. But for me, it scares the heck out of me where society's going. But keep in mind, we're already enlightened. We're already perfectly enlightened. What does that mean? It means we can just backflip into another realm is what it actually means. Skate off a rail and land it, plant it, you know, in just another scenario, actually. We don't even have to say we're already there. You know, we're already wherever we want to be. Say, I'm already wherever I want to be. And I don't know how I got there or when I got there or anything about it. I just know that I'm already where I want. I'm wherever I want to be. I am wherever I want to be. Doing whatever I want to do. There's no rhyme or reason to it. No explanation for it. No explanation for it. So I made an impassioned plea to Longchenpa, a truly impassioned plea. I don't know how I could have possibly done any better. So it's in his hands. I trust his judgment. So whatever his judgment is, I trust it. Plain and simple. the intensity is like crackling. Yeah, it's just a. It's like a 360 degree appeal, you know. It's all angles. And I should have said, and if you think I've petitioned you so far, you haven't heard anything yet. You haven't heard anything yet. I didn't add that one, I added it now. Longchenpa, if you think that petition was it, no, you haven't heard anything yet. Just starting the petition, you know. But feel free to decide any moment. We must bring the Dharma, true Dharma here. Extreme similarities to what Dzogchenpa is conveying to us and what Jesus Christ is conveying to us in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, especially Journey Beyond Words, but both extreme similarity, so much so that after being with A Course in Miracles for almost 40 years, to come across Longchenpa, it was like, oh, yeah, this isn't a problem for me. This feels very familiar to me. This is very familiar. Yeah. So it was like this wonderful, easy fit kind of thing. Nobody more adamant than Jesus Christ in what he says. Nobody's more adamant. So I come from that almost 40 years of that. So I tend to be very adamant. And I believe Longchenpa loves this. Really loves it. Hearing it's like music to his ears. Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodowi, he greeted me, he was crying. Yeah, maybe he just, you know, he just loved my how adamant I was. He says, it's just music to my heart. You know, this is heart music. This is what I love to hear. This is what I love to hear. I don't hear it enough. Oh, I really love hearing this. Well, thank Jesus Christ. Don't thank me. Go thank Jesus. You can thank me too. I mean, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. So I've been drinking. So, you know, yeah, you can thank me too. And be sure to thank Jesus Christ. Thank him, thank him, thank him. Let us all thank Jesus Christ. For petitioning us, saying, brothers, I petition you to give me, listen to my petition. I petition you to give me a hearing. So I gave him a hearing because the way he petitioned me, I said, you know, it's coming from the heart. So I'll listen to you. I'll give you a listen. You know, this is how you truly feel. This is what you truly believe. I can tell it's authentic. You're coming from the heart. So I will give you a fair hearing, Jesus. What did you have to say? And so I studied A Course in Miracles, studied Journey Beyond Words, the other voice, and said, okay, I get what you're saying. I get your petition. I hear it. I'll make a judgment on it. I judge for it. I judge for it. I grant you the request. You know, I grant you my attention. I grant you my attention. I say what you're saying is valid. I'm deciding in your favor. Opposed to all the other teachings, I'm deciding in your favor. This is what, okay, so yeah. Based on a fair hearing. So Jesus really, in his essence, petitioned us. And this quite, he humbled himself and petitioned us, quite extraordinary. He said, I know you may not believe this, and you may not like this, etc., but hear me well, and give me a hearing, please. Listen to what I have to say, and take it to heart. And I say this with so much love to you, and I'm not trying to upset you or scare you or anything, but this is, listen to what I have to say. And listen, and take it to heart, and don't forget it. Take it seriously. As much as possible, go listen to what I, as much as possible, take to heart to what I'm saying. So see, we're given this time, we're quiet time, because this is just extraordinary what we're going over here. This is the right way to do it. We're already enlightened and have no idea how, what, when, where, why, but it's true. There's nothing I can do about it. Nothing I can do about it. So this is how you feel when you practice this way. You just feel like sitting here quietly. Now, if you go into sort of a statue-like condition of withdrawing your attention to from the body, which has happened to me a number of times, the tip that I told you, I'll tell you again, is you have your hands, like this kind of. You're either like this or like this. Just I keep my hands like this kind of, just like this. not fingers like this, but one going over the other like that, and then the two thumbs just like that, okay? And when I start to wake up from a comatose, not comatose, I'm sorry, it's withdrawn from the body. You don't feel like moving the body. You've forgotten all about the body. Your attention is not on the body, really. You don't could care less about the body. It's like a statue. You don't even feel it. Not really. You don't care. And you realize you don't really feel like moving the body or doing anything with the body at all. Not at all. So you stay like a statue. You're not just unmoving. You know the body's there, but you have no interest in moving it or doing anything with the body. So how do you, you know, get out of that and when you need to move on? I kind of feel like a little bit that way right now. Okay, the key is start to wiggle the tips of your thumbs just a little bit. I know you can't see this because it's too bright, the light, but just wiggle, wiggle, wiggle. Just a little wiggle your thumbs just like this, okay? Then wiggle the thumbs up a little more, a little more, a little more. And then start wiggling your fingertips, okay? Just sort of wiggle your thumbs, wiggle your fingertips just like that in your hand. Just so you're, and then start to then move your hands a little bit. Start to move your hands, then your arms a little bit, and then just scratch. You'll come out of it. Oh. Now we're not leaving our body. It's just that we don't care. We're not interested. There's no interest in doing anything with our body. That's all. Just an attitude. So that's how I do it, and I highly recommend this, is you just wiggle the thumb tips first, then a little more, and then the fingers, start wiggling the fingers, then start moving your wrists, your hands with your wrists, then your arms and your shoulders a little bit, and then that takes you out of it. You're back, and you can move now. But I've gotten in some states of mind where I didn't have any desire whatsoever to associate with the body or move the body or do anything with the body. I was enjoying my mental freedom from the body, my mental space, unimpinged by having to do anything with the body. And it was very difficult to get back to the body and do anything with it. I didn't want to. I didn't want to ever do anything again with it. You know, I was just not interested. Not interested in the body. I'm not interested in food, the body, festivals, doing it, anything really. I'm not really interested right now. Interested in making a safeboard movie of some sort. I mean, just that intrigues me. That possibility is going to be pretty cool. Is it possible? I don't know. Yeah, it's possible. I have to do a lot of creative editing. I don't know if I should do it or not, but maybe. It's a challenge. It's a challenge. I'm not sure what I need to be doing, but so that keeps me going. If I didn't have something like that, I just might freeze up. You know, people might say, well, you're depressed. I don't feel like doing anything. Well, I could easily be depressed. I really don't feel like doing much of anything, really. So taping is the one thing I like to do. And so if you're depressed, you have to find something that you really like to do, and then just do that. Just feel something that you really want to do, and then just do that. Just do it. That's it. And you will find that you're not really so depressed anymore. It's okay to not really want to do anything. But as long as you're in this world, you should at least do something. It doesn't really quite matter what it is. just that you feel that it's inspiring you, that it's inspiring, you can do it. Intensity of this one will stay with me. Yeah, you know, I just have to get used to it. Just get used to this tremendous, impassioned intensity, an amazing practice, an amazing what has happened is amazing. I gave this tremendous petition to Longchenpa. Just that's an amazing event in world history. Really, it's an amazing event. I'm, you know, just a bit stunned by it. Significant event, a very significant event. Petitioning someone like Longchenpa like that is a very significant event. Has tremendous ramifications. Historic ramifications, actually. And I know it. So it was, I'm very, very intense. But I said, you know what? That's what I came here for. So that's what I did. All right. Very great. That's it for this one. And we don't know what's next, do we? But it will be even more inspiring.